Good morning, this is Daz on the Cat, the Tune and the Red, and we're really excited this morning to have one of the most exciting bands around at the moment. It's Red Rum Club. The band is made up of vocalist Fran, Tom on guitar, Michael on rhythm guitar, Simon on bass, Neil on drums, and their famed trumpet player, Joe. The group is often hailed as the next big thing, and to prove it, they're just about to embark on a sellout tour, which visits the Northeast on Friday, and then climaxes at the M&S Bank Arena in Liverpool, before a huge tour across America. And to show our love for the band, I went on and had a look. We've played their songs over 3,000 times in the last year, and their new single, Afternoon, was named Single of the Week by our new music panel just this Monday. We're honoured to have them on the show. Please welcome Michael and Tom from the Red Rum Club.
Hello.
How are we doing, gents? Yeah, you must be all really excited, ready to start the tour.
I think half the lads are excited to get on the bus and go to sleep on the way.
Really?
But then when we wake up, we'll be very excited to play the first show of the tour, yeah. Very excited.
And this must be an exciting time for you as a band, the new album getting in at number 8 on the UK album chart, fending off names like Taylor Swift, Olivia Rodrigo, and, you know, all that riffraff. So it must be a really, really exciting time for the band.
Yeah, I mean, we're still in the midst of it in terms of the shows and the gigging, but we feel very fulfilled that, you know, a year ago now it was, we recorded this record and so proud of it, and we really hoped and manifested that we'd be able to get it inside the top 10. That was a kind of goal for us. And the morning we woke up and we got the news from one of our friends at the label, I think it was just a feeling of relief.
Yeah.
But yeah, we're very happy indeed.
And it's a really exciting time for fans as well. We're going to get out and see you across the country. I'm coming down to the Newcastle gig as well. I'm really excited to see you guys again. I've seen you a couple of times now at the Coup Bar in Stockton, which, quite frankly, were probably two of the best nights of my life. They're a brilliant, sweaty mess with six mates having the best night of their lives. What can audiences expect when they come and see this tour?
Probably something similar, to be honest. Yeah. So, we haven't really stretched our legs in a long time playing wise. We had some shows in December in some smaller rooms. That was nice, but we feel like we haven't done a full UK tour, a full UK run in a while. We're keen to get going, really.
And for those people who are just finding Red Rum Club at the moment, you know, they might be just from this album, it might be from some of the singles. Can you tell us a little bit about the origins of Red Rum Club and how the band came together?
Yeah, it's quite a long-winded story, so we'll try and kind of abbreviate it. By the way, with KU Bar, we've got to give a shout-out to Jimmy Beck.
Yeah.
Who always looks after us when we go there, so well in Jimmy.
Yeah, they're brilliant mates, aren't they?
So Tom and Francis, the lead singer, they're cousins.
Right.
So obviously they've known each other their whole lives. And then I think probably when they were like 10, 11 or something, they asked for guitars for Christmas. And they both got a guitar for Christmas so they could both sit there and, you know, kind of learn some of the chords to some bands and songs that they liked. And those two, they kind of, it stemmed from there with those two, and they kind of went on their journey. And then the other lads, we're all lucky. We grew up and we went to school in a place called Crosby, kind of North Liverpool. Some really nice schools, and, you know, there was lots of chances in the schools, like music classes and Battle of the Bands and loads of bits and bobs. So when we were into our music and our bands, we had loads of opportunities to get gigging and playing and practicing together. We all kind of met through school and college and kind of played in separate bands until one day we kind of formed like a Crosby super group type thing. And we've been going for years now. We've just been enjoying it. We never really imagined that it'd reach like the kind of levels it's reaching for us now. We just wanted to go into a pub and get free ale and impress some girls or whatever. But this is next level for us. It's amazing.
It is, and it's fantastic. And obviously, being from Liverpool, the home of British music, would you say that Liverpool influences your sound?
Yeah, I think it's inevitable. You know, when you grow up in the shadow of bands like the Beatles and the Lars and the Coral and the Zootons, Echo and the Bunnymen, just to name a few, like, you know, that handful of bands, if you grow up in the same place where those bands formed and honed their craft, I think you'd be silly not to take some influence from that.
Yeah.
So we obviously have done, but I think we also, you know, we like to set our stall further afield as well. You know, we're very interested in our own journey in America and, you know, other places around the world. And, you know, we like to think we've got something universal there, given the opportunity.
I mentioned it before, we play your music a heck of a lot here on the stations. We're big fans, and we loved the new album. Your single Afternoon this week was voted our single of the week. The new album, you know, what was the process for writing that like? How does six people all get their voices heard in the process? Is it a collaborative thing, or is it more sort of do things come together?
After a certain point that right. is like the kind of the writing of the songs is Tom.
Right.
So I'll put you on to Tom, head of songwriting.
Hello, Tom here, head of songwriting.
You know, I was just talking about the process in putting the latest album together.
It was kind of a lot of the songs come pretty naturally. We did. There was a bit of an environmental shift since we moved out of our practice room in like the heart of Liverpool in town. It was quite like a built up metropolis and stuff, and we'd have a quite cushy, nice aircon room and like a little cafe above our room. We could go get a little latte and stuff, but it was just a bit too expensive for us. So we ended up moving to like a warehouse on the docks in Bootle, which is, you know, it had like this. A few weeks after we moved into it, we were a little bit like, what have we done here? And it was like freezing, it was raffing, it was all this. But slowly we turned it into a bit of a HQ,
right.
where a lot of the writing was done. And we were doing demos in this place, and it was like, there's a big scrapyard next door, and like, there's just a lot of noise that's built onto the demos, which at first we saw as a hindrance, but some of them sounds actually ended up molding the shape for the record and actually making the record. Yeah. So once we had that kind of theme, the songwriting kind of fell into it. And it became this industrial sounding piece of work, which we're really proud of.
We're all like Slipknot banging on dustbins.
Yeah.
Do you have a favourite on the album?
Personally, my favourite would be Changes a lot. I think I'd say Houdini today, but I'm a big fan of Undertaker. Undertaker feels the most like, you know, it's like wobbly. It's like the chords are a bit, they aren't really like by the book, and like a few times you're like, what is that noise kind of thing with a guitar tone and stuff. So I like playing that live.
Well, audiences will get to see you play live on this fantastic tour that you're going on at the moment. You've also played loads of festivals around the country as well. What are some of your favourite audiences to play?
Anyone who's drunk, really.
Anyone who's up for it. Sometimes a place by surprise as well.
Yeah.
You know, you'll go to a place, and not that you have low expectations of anything anytime, but I think your mood on that day, if you're feeling a little bit tired, you might feel like the gig's going to be a little bit lackluster, and then sometimes you could step out on stage. Like we did one in December in the Lead Mill in Sheffield, and just like when you go out and you feel like the crowd's up for it, I don't know, it just makes you almost feel kind of superhuman sometimes.
Yeah, well, sometimes there's places that don't get a lot of passing bands like coming through.
Right, yeah, so,
like,
I'm with you.
But we'll go, sometimes never even hearing of the place or the venue.
Yeah.
And we'll just open. The room will be full, and like you don't get a lot of bands coming this way, and especially when we're some people's favorite bands in the room, they just kind of lose themselves for the night, and it's amazing to see.
Yeah,
quite cathartic.
Do you have any rituals or routines before you go in on stage before the gig? Do you have a big rider?
Yeah, to be honest with you.
Yeah, loads of leftover ham, and all the ale's gone, and we just take the ham on tour with us
on the bus.
Never gets it. That's right. Like VIP. It's like we'll pick up loads, like the venue get us loads of ham on the first day, and we're like, oh, we'll take that for the next gig. Take it to the next gig, we never eat it there.
Joe's a vegan, he's just sat on the bus, like loads of ham.
Got its own bump on the bus, and we just take this ham on tour. It's basically what it's all about nowadays.
The ham is the support act, I think, on this.
We should make one of them fan pages where it's like the ham on tour. We don't really do, but we take a load of butter and hummus. And ham around on tour with us.
Before we have a quick game of the Red Rum Club Jukebox, what's next for you guys? Obviously, you've got this huge sellout tour, the big arena in Liverpool, the tour of America. What's next?
Probably, obviously, for the foreseeable, we've got a bit of a plan, but we need to. I want to get back in the studio as quick as we can.
If we tell you, we'll have to tell you.
All right, okay. Fair enough, then.
We've got goals like that we want to kind of, like, Tom. As the guy, he's the main writer. Like, he's always thinking it within the year. Like, it's a bit of a mixed bag. Like, Tom's thinking, when can we write? When can we demo some more tracks and maybe look at the next record? And then I think there's like all the lads love the touring, so we're always looking at like where and when can we squeeze in a tour, what festivals are we going to be lucky enough to appear at, and we just kind of go from there with it. Like, but like we say, we're happy, we're proud of it, and I'm sure, you know, if there's a song that you don't hear in the set list on this tour, let us know and we'll try and get it in the one on the next tour.
Yeah, because you've got a big presence on social media. I know that's a big part of the band, and a huge, huge following across the UK and America. Can't wait to see you up in the Northeast at the Newcastle University Friday night. Can we just have a quick game of Red Rum Club Jukebox? Basically, we've got six of your songs lined up, labelled 1 to 6. You just pick a number, we'll tell you the song, and tell us a little bit about that song, just about how it came about, any interesting stories to do with those songs. Start off, give us a number from the jukebox, guys.
6.
6, Kids Addicted. Can you tell us a bit about that?
That was written with the producer of the last album, actually, Rich Turvey. I think we wrote it about 2019, was it, or something like that?
It was before last album.
It's probably the one of the first like real collaborative songs written with it.
The first ever co-write.
Yeah.
That was fun.
And it was basically written in one day. It was kind of like, just kind of fell out of us as soon as we started it. I think I had some of the lyrics just on a note, like it wasn't a song, it was just some, right. I think I have preacher problems on the medium that caused them on a note, and we kind of ran with that. I think Rich delivered like the opening riff, which is also the
quite
pre-chorus.
Interesting co-writing with Rich, because he was like, he had some kind of things, he was like, whatever it is, he wanted us to say, we are there, so everyone can sing
right,
together. Like,
yeah, yeah.
And like something that feels kind of representative of people, and it was a new experience for us, but I think we learnt a lot that day, and it's for a while now, it's been like in our top 5 most streamed songs, and it always gets a good reaction live. It's a nice upbeat song that we like playing. Joe was really drunk when he recorded it solo.
Letting out all the secrets now.
Yeah, he come in, he just started a new job in a bar. And then he come in to record his solo, and he was a little bit tipsy, and he just blasted that solo out, not thinking like he's gonna have to play that every day for the next 3 years.
Brilliant. All right, give us another number from the jukebox.
Number 2.
Would you rather be lonely?
Oh yeah, pick another number.
All right, okay.
Lonely was like you heard a couple arguing or something. Yeah, that song's become like folklore now a little bit to me.
That
yeah.
Sounds quite big-headed today, but like it feels like it was first of all written so long ago that I can't even remember how it come about. It was just kind of like, I remember it being, again though, it was quite cooperative, where it was like a few of us in the room. I remember we needed like the riff over it, over the top.
I remember you like went outside and come up with a guitar riff.
And it was the most complex, like it's quite a complex riff, but for some reason people all think it. Which is always shock. A lot of things shock me about that song, yeah. Especially its success being the main thing that shocks me.
Just the fact that that's the one people want to sing, like that we have at the end and stuff, and that's the one people sing. We never intended it to be that. We were just writing another tune, and I remember Tom come in and he just heard like a fella arguing with his missus, and he just said it. Like, and we've never heard that be said. You know, when you hear some sayings and stuff, usually a little bit more expletive than. Would you rather be lonely? But
yes.
Would you rather be lonely? And I think Tom come in and he said he'd heard someone say it. So shout out to them too as well. Hopefully they've sorted out their...
yeah, hopefully.
Right.
Okay, another number.
Let's go lucky number 3.
Vibrate.
Vibrate. probably one of our favourites to play live. Vibrates.
I have to say it's a totally fictional story. Really? But yeah, it was kind of conjured up in lockdown. I remember writing it in lockdown. I had the riff, and I knew I wanted it to be a bit like, have like a Fleetwood Mac kind of Dreams kind of feel.
All right.
Which is the drums and bass is basically that.
Bump to Fleetwood Mac.
Yeah, thank you. Big thanks to Fleetwood Mac. But then the story, I kind of just kind of thought of this scenario. I think I got the hook first, like the it was on Vibrate, and I was like, what could that mean, kind of thing.
Yeah.
But I am saying it's a fictional story, but I do always picture a certain house that we used to go out and house parties in when we were younger. And for some reason, when I hear that song, it takes place in this house. But yeah, that's all the information I can divulge for the sake.
Well, that's fair enough. Okay, we'll leave it at that. One more number from the jukebox, please.
You have number 5.
Yeah.
Eleanor.
It's about my missus, that.
When I'm alone, I fill the void with a box of Polaroids. My stones in sepia tone, wondering where the time has flown to. Better believe you're still my girl. From the rooftop, tell the world I'm the one you call upon when the night gets rough and the morning's long. But the song won't get you far. E-L-E-A-N-O-R. Know just what you are to me.
Oh, it's about Tom wrote that for his girlfriend.
Yeah, that was just a mistake. No, it was written for me, yeah. That would have been lockdown as well, wouldn't it?
I just remember she was struggling.
Yeah, it was like a bit of a pep talk of a song. But it was so hooky that it was just kind of like, it was really easily written, I remember that.
Yeah.
And it's just like, it is kind of a pop song, 101.
That's one of the songs, I think there's one song per album that I think Tom brings in that's quite personal.
Right.
Like on album 2, Hollow Humdrum, it was Eleanor. Like he's written that as like, his partner was not, you know, just like not having the most fun time in the world. And it was kind of like a pick-me-up for her. So when a song comes in like that, that's like that personal, the lads don't really touch it.
Yeah.
Because, like, it can be collaborative, but some at the right time and place.
Resonate. Obviously, it's a name song, so, like, there's a lot of Eleanors who get in touch with us and, like, that stuff, which is nice. But I think people just relate to it in a lot. Just
I
like
love it when Elle comes. When Elle, like, when the girls come to a gig, or if Elle comes to it and someone's like, are you Eleanor?
I find it funny that Frances, the lead singer's sister, is called Eleanor.
Right.
So she has to sing it every...
Does she think it was about her?
Well, it's Tom's cousin, so it'd be a little bit weird.
Also
oh, yeah,
cousin.
Yeah, all right. That's, yeah, I suppose, yeah, okay.
Cow.
Incestual.
Listen, guys, thank you so much for your time this morning. It's a real pleasure speaking to you. Really looking forward to seeing you guys again at the Newcastle University. I think there's maybe a handful of tickets, which will probably be gone by the time we finish this interview. Good luck with the tour, guys. Good luck with your trip to America as well. Yeah, we wish you all the very best.
We appreciate it. Thank you very much for having us.
All right, and will you still come? You know, when you're filling out the stadiums, will you still come back and talk to us across the northeast?
Nah, no chance.
Yeah, right, I thought that might be the case.
Of course.
Take it easy, guys. And we'll look forward to seeing you on Friday night. Take care.